Good morning. My name is Bill Courtney. It's a great pleasure to be here this morning. We have a terrific panel. Our panel will be addressing the politics of the Eurasian Union. I'd begin just by offering a couple of thoughts on the politics of the European Union that might have some implications for the Eurasian Economic Union. Three principal lessons. The first is that it's easier to begin with economics than politics, and it's easier to begin with trade than finance. So at the time the European coal and steel community was formed, a little bit over a decade after World War II, it would not have been possible to achieve the kind of political unity that the European Union has achieved in recent years. And it was much easier to begin with trade than finance, as we have seen with the subsequent development of the euro. And in fact, it is the single market, the open trading, which has been the most popular part of the European Union. The second lesson learned from European Union is that it is economic inefficiency that breeds a lot, maybe most, political frictions in the European Union. Slow growth has been a plague for the European Union, and one wonders now, how much more difficult is it for the European Union to deal with such issues as the refugee crisis because of the slow growth problem? In fact, until the refugee crisis, when one used the phrase EU crisis, most people thought of slow economic growth in the European Union. So inefficiency as a source of political friction is a key issue. The third lesson in the European Union is that unity and solidarity do not always substitute for reform. France has the highest state participation in its domestic economy of any of the countries in the in the European Union, and it's having great difficulties coming to grips with real reform, which it needs to improve its economic prospects. Italy has 15 years of no productivity growth. Now, partly one can attribute that maybe to the euro experience and other things, but fundamentally, this is an issue where Italy has relied on solidarity and unity and open trading arrangements as a substitute, but not really tackled real reform, which now Prime Minister Renzi is doing. So of these three implications then for the European Union, Eurasian Economic Union, first, of course, one lesson is it's best to stick with trade in the Eurasian Economic Union. It's far too soon to speak of a common currency. Second, the European Union opened its economy and promoted economic efficiency. The Eurasian Economic Union is essentially a protectionist instrument lodged in between two of the three largest world economies, Europe and East Asia, and this will breed inefficiency and is likely to breed more political frictions, not only internally. For example, Kazakhstanis are upset that it costs a lot more to buy an imported car now than before they were in the European Union, but it is also going to breed political friction with China and Europe if a protectionist Eurasian Economic Union ends up being an impediment rather than a facilitator of the free flow of goods across the Eurasian landmass. And then third potential implication for the Eurasian Economic Union is that creation of union is not going to substitute for the urgency of domestic reform in Russia, Belarus, Kazakhstan, and the others. So we have seen now in the last year and a half, the most striking economic reforms have been economic reforms that countries have taken themselves. Essentially, it's to float the ruble, float the tenge, and of course Ukraine has done something similar. Secondly, more recently, we have seen that countries are not looking to the Eurasian Economic Union to deal with their fundamental economic problems. They're looking to domestic reforms, which have been harder to address. So Kazakhstan has talked about speeding up the privatization of enterprises. It's been talking about this for years, but now it seems to be more willing to do something. And then the biggest surprise of the last week or so has been Vladimir Putin calling in heads of seven state enterprises to talk about privatization. So it's important, looking at the European Union, to realize that that unity is not a substitute for tackling the tough issues of structural economic reform at home. With that, let's begin. We'll just go right down the line. Alex Cooley, everyone knows, is director of the Columbia University's Harriman Institute for the Study of Russia, Eurasia, and Eastern Europe, and a professor of political science at Barnard College of Columbia University. Alex?
Oh, thanks so much. Yep. it's a great pleasure to be here. Thank you to Angela. Thank you to Michael for this invitation. This is just a fascinating group that you've assembled here and offering all sorts of different perspectives. And actually, I think my own views on what I wanted to contribute here certainly evolved as I thought a little bit about the conference and its purpose and the theme of evolution I took seriously. So actually, I want to do something perhaps a little bit different. I'm not going to talk a lot about Central Asia, if any, because there are a lot of distinguished Central Asian panelists here, and also we'll hear from our Chinese and Russian colleagues about some of these issues. And instead, I want to put back my international relations hat on and talk a little bit about how theories of integration and comparative examples of integration can give us some leverage on some of the problems and challenges confronting the EEU. In other words, I want to sort of talk about what is the EEU a case of? Okay, just that very sort of base. You know, what are the sort of metrics that we should use to look at it? What are some of the concepts? Then I want to get at what I find to be the essential problem of all regional organizations. That's the problem of credibility and leadership, and talk about how these are particularly acute in the EEU case. Then, as far as growing pains go, the first year of the EEU actually exacerbated a lot of these dilemmas about credibility, and so we'll give an overview of those. And then, based on this analysis, I want to address the two kind of areas of engagement that a lot have been written about. EU engagement with China, on the one hand, and its various Silk Road, One Belt, One Road initiatives, and then this burning question now on whether the EU should engage with the EEU. But I want to do it from this kind of conceptual, analytical perspective coming back. Okay, so I find a lot of commentary, especially here in Washington and New York, I'm not just picking on Washington, and in Brussels, to be deeply dissatisfying, right? We tend to have this image that the EU is the neo-Soviet Union, right? That Putin wants to resurrect the Soviet Union, and that the EU, along with these other regional integration instruments, are, you know, the modern equivalents to establishing Russian sort of hegemony over the post-Soviet space. And I find this analytically sloppy and deeply problematic too, right? Because I think it instantly turns the conversation into one of ideology, one of ideological contestation, and in the end, kind of a crude geopolitics. Instead, what I think we should be looking at, and the way I think Russians and members of the EU perceive the EU, is that we are in a world of regional organizations in both the economic and the security sphere. And most importantly of all, the EEU, just like the CSTO, are contemporary organizations, yes, driven in a large part by Russia, with a highly mimetic quality to them of being regional organizations in a globalized world, right? A lot of the form of the EEU takes its inspiration from the EU in terms of its supranational institutions, the court, the commission, the overall architecture of how it would like to proceed. And this is actually no different than a lot of areas of the world where you see regional organizations sprouting up, all of them with growing pains, by the way. Some are more established, like the EU, ASEAN. Others are in the middle of deepening, GCC, the AU, Mercosur, and so forth. So I want to take this into the realm of comparative regional studies as opposed to Cold War ideological studies, right? Eurasian Union actually has precursors, right? It didn't just materialize. It didn't just sprout up. Now, as scholars, I think we haven't been paying enough attention to them. There's some examples. Keith Darden's excellent book on Eurasian integration and regional integration, I think, is one exception. But there's a lineage here. Now, efforts at integration accelerate in the 2000s. This is true, right? The timing is not gradual, it's punctuated, right? That the 90s on the integration front tends to be dominated with sorting through a lot of these challenges of state building, economic reform, and then, of course, getting to grips with, you know, what the CIS can and can't do. And for the most part, it is toothless and it is problematic. But I think our understanding of the CIS in the 1990s has blinded us in some ways to tracing some of the real kind of analytical developments in the 2000s. So we do have a Eurasian Economic Community from 2000, a customs union from 2010 that's functioning relatively effectively, or it was actually before 2014. Then the single economic space in 2012 is the precursor to the Eurasian Union. We do have these steps of regional integration here. From an analytical point of view, putting on my poli-sci IR hat, the central problem that confronts all regional integrations is the credibility of leadership in an organization, right? Do the leading states in the region, right, can they credibly commit to a set of rules that will bind them and make their leadership acceptable to others, right? Are there rule sets, ideas, institutions that can be adopted, right, that will facilitate regional trade, perhaps finance, rule of law, these kinds of regional cooperation, and how can the leader in any particular regional organization sort of bind themselves? So credibility is absolutely key here. Now, kind of theories of international relations point to different sources or different sort of solutions, implicit solutions to the problem of credibility and how to realize gains from cooperation. For realists, actually, it's tough. If you want to minimize the credibility issue, you're actually going to have to deal with the relative gains problem, right? That it's not even about designing institutions. Is if one state is gaining more from a particular institutional arrangement and that threatens the sovereignty and power of another state, that's going to be deeply problematic. The constructivist tradition, focusing on political identity, focuses on ideas of political community, right? Forge trust through common identities, a sense of regional kind of community, and the security community's literature is a good example of this. But this would be sort of arguments advanced about what is Europe? What does it mean to join, the original sort of idea, the concept, and so forth. And neoliberal institutionalists talk about institutional design, right, as a way of mitigating credibility issues that solve transaction costs. They disseminate information, they monitor what an organization is doing, and they enforce the rules. I want to focus a little bit on some of the institutionalist arguments. And this draws on a book I have with Hendrik Spruit in 2009 called Contracting States, Sovereign Transfers, International Relations, when we deal with modes of regional integration. So I think the two main variables that we need to get a handle on here are relative power asymmetry with any regional organization and the type of contracting that you have, whether it's incomplete or complete. So power asymmetry is relatively straightforward, right? Is power concentrated within one country or is it diffused? Contracting comes down to, are the rules of the organization specified, right? Are they bounded and specified? Are the jurisdictions and the domains, the competencies clear? Are they written ex ante? Is there room for interpretation? And is there room for what we used to call spillover, right? Incomplete agreements are framework agreements, right? And they encourage possible expansion to other jurisdictions and domains, right? So one story of the EU is that it is a case of incomplete contract where supranational institutions like the court, like the commission, take on more and more functions as they can. Now, why is this important? There's actually two models that I think are instructive when we look at the EU. Yes, the EU is, I think, an interesting point of comparison because it's mimetic. And the EU have power moderately diffused amongst a number of large countries. Of course, arguably, Germany is the largest of the large. Contracts are relatively incomplete. And to solve this, you have deep supranationalism, right? EU institutions cope with this ever-expanding set of domains, these devolutions, making rules, adapting rules, and the tensions between supranationalism and domestic law. Now notice, the EU is the example of the deepest supranationalism it is, and it still has credibility issues, right? As Ambassador Courtney was saying, right? Is it going to enforce Schengen, right, now with the refugee flows, right? What about its rules for the euro? What about Brexit, right? So these issues, I don't want to make it seem as if the EU is perfect. Actually, even the EU and its deep structures has to deal with the credibility of its rules, right? NAFTA, though, I think is overlooked and I think is instructive. In NAFTA, you actually have a regional organization where power is highly asymmetrical, right? There is a hegemon. It's the US, but contracts are complete. If you look at NAFTA agreements, they're far more specified, actually, than the EU. Ex ante, all the categories of actions are bound, and there is no spillover. It's about trade, it's about investment, and nothing else, right? There's no question about migration or labor movement or a common currency or any of these things. And the supranationalism, as a result, is low, right? What you have in NAFTA for dispute settlement is ad hoc arbitration. In fact, it's usually extra NAFTA arbitration, right, going to arbitral tribunals convened by other international fora rather than a NAFTA court, right? There's no NAFTA court. That's what makes NAFTA work. So all this to say that these various elements are configured differently in the EU that I would argue exacerbates and heightens Russia's credibility challenge. You have very high power asymmetries. You have an incomplete contract where it's not clear what the boundaries of this institution are going to be. Are we going to go to a further currency? Are we going to have financial integration? Are we going to have legal integration? On what timetable? Where are these centers going to be? And as a result, we have also dysfunctional supranationalism. We have this mimetic Eurasian Economic Commission, but its credibility is in question. The bureaucracy itself is big, right? But its authority is fragmented. It's not clear what its relationship with the court is. It's not clear that even though it has supposed authority to implement decisions that domestic courts recognize or even understand that authority, problematic enforcement. And then most of all, the Russian side acts outside of the realm of these supranational institutions and uses side payments and threats, mostly energy, to actually even negotiate membership in the EU, right? So for all these reasons, actually, you know, I think Russia faces a massive credibility challenge as the leader of this organization. And so just a slide comparing power distribution in the EU and the EU compared. Okay, so if that wasn't challenging enough, 2014, the first year of the Eurasian Union, then brings up a number of challenges, right? Tug of war over Ukraine, right? Where suddenly the EU is viewed along with the EU, and the EU commissioners also contributed to this, right? So I'm not gonna blame this solely on Russia. We have Barroso's famous statements about that you have to choose. But this perception of the tug of war between the two, this being a sort of geopolitical bloc. As a result of Ukraine, you have the acceleration of negotiations in 2014, where Russia actually diminishes the standardization and power and credibility of its own rules so as to offer concessions to the entrants to come in on their own terms. So Belarus, for instance, gets back the re-export of Russian energy to Europe, right, that before that negotiators were sort of determined to take away from them in a very logical way to make the bloc credible. Armenia gets over 700 exemptions on EU duties and tariffs, right, as its sort of quid, while on the other hand, Moscow is using the threat of subsidized energy to sort of force them in. And then Kazakhstan, very interestingly, and as a lot of you have followed here, rejects all political initiatives, including the EU parliament, right, and sort of refers to, we're going to do this, but it's only going to be economic, right? So everyone kind of gets the sort of concession. And so in some ways, everyone is also operating on different kinds of institutional forms. Finally, we have the sanctions, right, and then the counter-sanctions. And what's important about the counter-sanctions is not just, you know, their destructive impact on economic activity. It's the process by which Moscow imposed counter-sanctions which was unilaterally, not consulting vis-a-vis the supranational mechanisms or with its partners. And this is why you get the reimposition of customs borders on the Belarusian border, right? Concerns about, you know, shrimp and foie gras sort of made in Belarus coming into Russia and so forth. But I think it exposes the fact that Russia did not use the institutions of the EU themselves to consult and to make this important decision. So these three, I would argue, all of them quite important kind of events in 2014 have even further heightened the credibility problem. You'll hear some facts and figures from others, I'm hoping today, but just to point out that in 2015, as opposed to 2014, trade within the EU is down. It's way down. Now, this is a function of all sorts of things. The sanctions, collapse in oil price, and so forth. But the numbers are pretty stark, right? Trade within the EU is down over a third year to year, and that's significant. Okay, so then, based on this analysis, how do we then approach the important policy question of engagement with the EU and modalities of engagement? So let me just quickly touch upon sort of China and the EU. So a lot of it has been talked about sort of whether the EU is compatible with the Chinese new plans for Obor and these new routes that will go south and west and north. And the way I look at it is, two answers. Fundamentally, no, but tactically, perhaps. Fundamentally, why do I say no? Because actually, the Chinese initiative, the grand strategic vision, is antithetical with the Russian one. As Ambassador Courtney says, the Russian one is about creating barriers so as to create a common economic space that is a geopolitical entity, that is a region. The Chinese initiative, right, in its geopolitical version, is about connecting space. Right? It's about connecting the Middle East to East Asia. It's about connecting Europe. In other words, Eurasia is a transit corridor, right, through which this connectivity and this integration takes place. Why do I say tactically yes? Because that's the grand geostrategic vision of Obor, but there are domestic drivers. And the domestic drivers are Chinese companies, firms, municipalities, regions that are looking at rapidly declining growth rates, already over capacity and need new outlets for markets, right? Machine construction, exporters, cement, asphalt, and so forth. So for them, the Eurasian space itself is somewhere to invest, right, now that the Chinese market is saturated the way it is. So these kinds of issues are being resolved by these brand new negotiations between Chinese and EU and Russian delegations trying to marry the two projects. They don't address issue number one because I think it's incompatible. So instead, what you're looking at are sort of technical criteria for issue number two. And for me, the difficulty is it's really hard to provide a set of rules so comprehensive, right, that you manage all these. And besides, there are other factors that are going to affect the relationship much more than what these commissions decide. The exchange rate, absolutely critical in terms of how this is going to reorient incentives. Oil price, absolutely critical in terms of volume of trade. And then again, what I see sort of emerging out of this is that there will be some symbolic concession to deal with the EU as an actor, but in terms of actual substance, it's going to be very difficult to ensure that somehow all these Chinese companies, all these Chinese actors check in with some agreement before they do what they're doing in the region. So I think integration takes place increasingly on China's terms if there is going to be an agreement. EU and EU, this is a much, much more difficult question in some ways. I think this is just a straight political issue. I really do. I agree with, analysts like Nate Shinkan and Rico Dragneva that the economic case hasn't been made. But on the other hand, the EU engages with all sorts of other regional integrations where the economic case isn't that strong. There are working dialogues, quite established working dialogues, with Mercosur, with ASEAN, with GCC, right? The EU engages externally with a number of regional organizations, whether it makes sort of great economic sense or not. So this is a political issue on whether the EU should engage with the EU And it's ultimately one that some have argued, something like Crash, Jeff, and Leonard, should be part of a grand settlement over, you know, kind of Ukraine and Syria and so forth. And others have argued, well, why reward Moscow's coercion of sort of small states by sort of engaging with this thing? But there's different forms of engagement. Some are substantive, some are not. And so I'd like to see the discussion actually go more towards that. Like what would engagement actually look like? Would you have a dialogue, a working group, technical criteria, specification? Would you work on credibility issues? Would you have a human rights dialogue? Would you have a standards dialogue? Right, as opposed to yes or no. The yes or no is just pure politics as far as I'm concerned. Okay, so just to wrap up, and thank you for indulging me with time. The EU is not a neo-Soviet Union. We shouldn't study it as such. We shouldn't refer to it as such. And research on regional organizations, I think, gives us some of the concepts to understand the comparative and the very distinctive challenges that it faces. It's highly asymmetrical. There's incomplete contracting, and it has underdeveloped and fragmented supranational institutions, which are really going to challenge it becoming the type of hefty regional organization it wants to be. Arash's credibility further undermined by the events of 2014. And I think the EU faces tough challenges, different types of challenges in dealing with China and the EU. Thank you.
Professor Cooley's comment that the EU is not a neo-Soviet Union should be seen in the context of a comment from a person who is now a presidential candidate when she was Secretary of State a few years ago. Dr. Feng is currently director at the Center for Russian Studies at East China Normal University and director of the Center for Co-Development with Neighboring Countries in Shanghai. Oops.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Professor Understand. Thank you for such kind of invitation that only I can get chance to do the speech here. But also, in audience, I found so many old friends. I would be very happy. According requirements organizers, my today's topic is China's perception of the Eurasian Union and Sino-Russia cooperation in Central Asia. Of course, that is a very big topic related to so many the acknowledgement area, and also we can use so many the concepts to interpret such kind of very complicated process. But the very limited time, so I only like introduce some general idea and the main process and some the biggest challenges. First, this part means how the Chinese people understand the Eurasia and Eurasia the space, such kind of the thing. First, Chinese tend to look at the contemporary significant international changes from evolutionary viewpoint. The first, the sudden end of the Cold War is not decided by the outcome of the war. But instead by the complex causes and effects. The Cold War ended without any loser, actually. Maybe such kind of present similar to President Obama. The heritage of the Soviet Union can hardly suddenly disappear. There still exists various close economic, political, cultural, and social ties among the former Soviet Union countries. Of course, this is a very complicated picture. And also, we can understand such kind of situation by different understanding. For example, Vladimir Putin many times emphasized such kind of situation. And also, I think the Western U.S. and the European friend also pay attention so much to interpret such kind of very complicated pictures. Third, it is better to try to find linkages between the past and the future than simply artificially cut off such traditional links. The Eurasian Union is actually an outcome of this background. I mean, for Chinese people, I think that is very natural process. We can't imagine that one day how the situation will be changing. Secondly, for Chinese people, we are also accustomed to view the Eurasian Union both pragmatically and from the long-term economic perspective. The first, recovering the social and economic potentials, improve the market mechanism and management level in Eurasia is more important than the decline of Sino-Russian bilateral trade on short term. Why? Because now also we face so many debates about how we can look at Eurasian Union, its impact on China-Russia bilateral economic relations. Somebody argues that last some years trade and investment decline. But I think Eurasian Union as the repositions of the Russia national strategy prepared to both participate in competition, cooperation, and the gradual opening up. I think for long term, that is good. That is good. So, China's perception to Eurasian Economic Union are also decided by its expectations for security and social stability within its neighboring area. By the way, I'd like to mention that even 2,000 years ago, when Chinese people established the old Silk Road, the motivation not only based on economic exchange, but also based on some security concern. That means how we can get a guarantee for our northern west part territory. Of course, contemporary three evil, terrorism, separatism, extremism, always very serious threat for China's security issue. And also, I think that is very important point. I think the compare with Russia, China's security force are still very weak. Fourth, the political development of the Eurasia region is also a concern of China. The political dimension, of course, is very complicated. First of all, emerging independent countries in this region have a strong desire to determine their own internal and external affairs based on sovereignty, equality, and independence. I think, first of all, that is Central Asian countries. I think this is very clear. Secondly, Russia's changes and the possibility of overcoming the empire's heritage in this region. Just like some scholars wrote that really Eurasia Union based not only single country's political will is also based on sincere cooperation among Russia and some central countries. That kind of motivation is true. It's true, but of course, also face the serious challenge. Fifth, establishment of Eurasian Union is also reflection to current global changes. First of all, a trend after the financial crisis in 2008. Towards geopolitical and economical games has been mainly demonstrated at the regional level. I think the international politics is gradually entering a new period of both competition and cooperation. Of course, there are so many newer institutions and regional integration design suddenly appeared just during this period. So under such kind of background, Eurasia units appear, I think that is logically. Six, Chinese view of the Eurasia Union are also related with peace, with the peace in history 100 years ago. In the middle of Fernandez, the idea to build a big railway between the two ends of the Eurasia continent was again proposed. Actually, this idea was also proposed in fundamentals of national reconstruction by Chinese Democratic Revolutionary Dr. Sun Yat-sen. Second problem, China's cooperation with Russia in Central Asia. First, the coordination of Russia's Eurasian Union and China's One Belt, One Road initiative. The concept of the coordination means to connect these two almost completely different regional cooperation models, try all possibilities to cooperate instead of conflict against each other. It is a very difficult, I should emphasize, that is very difficult. But we need such kind of imperative experiment. By the way, I'd like to say one word about coordination in English. In Russia, from according to official document, in Russia, we call it soprajenie. Alexander, you tonight about it. Soprajenie, if we translate it to English, how we can to translate?
Conjunction. Conjunction.
Yeah. Yeah, conjunction, that is one thing. And also, I asked somebody that is very high level interpreter, they told me that there are different understanding. You, one case, and also coordination, and also combine and another. Mm-hmm. Even high level word is integrate, but I'm afraid of using the integrate, that is different. It's difficult to, it's hard to integrate. So let me temporarily use the coordination. Okay, we can discuss, of course. why I say so different things, and why I should say we should prevent such kind of possible conflict between the both regional integrated idea. Because even I think the lessons from Ukraine crisis provide our many things. I think we can consider such kind of very terrible situation many more. I think there are some idea. First of all, China's accession in to the Eurasia Economic Union. This is the first choice. However, it seems that neither Russia nor China is willing to adopt this scheme. Some aspects argue we can do such kind of new union between China and Russia and the Eurasia Economic Union. But I don't think that is a good way. Secondly, some members, particularly from Central Asia experts, they argue that we can establish more close bilateral cooperation with China beyond the framework Eurasia Union. I don't think, of course, currently we face many such kind of idea, suggestion from some of the countries, particularly from Central Asia. But I don't think, of course, we can do something. But if beyond the Eurasia framework, it will be difficult. So that means to how degree we can cooperate with our Central Asian partner. That is a problem. That is a problem. The thirdly, so-called coordination based on existing framework of SCO, Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Maybe this is the only way now we can promote cooperation between Russia and China on the base of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Secondly, even if a roadmap has been decided like this, Sino-Russia cooperation in Central Asia may still encounter serious challenges. What does it mean? The sharp decline in energy prices and the current crisis has brought the most severe economic pressure to both Russia and Central Asia. I think, of course, since to 2010, and last 2 months, we had been Russia and some Central Asian countries. Really, we got a clear feel that situation really seriously. Secondly, Russia and Central Asian countries, yes, you can't come to overall agreement regarding some of the major issues, including common currency and political allies. That is very current problem, particularly I think after the Ukraine crisis. Maybe Central Asia's people's perception also changed dramatically. That is the current situation. Thirdly, debates about cooperation with China between Central Asia countries and Russia also even openly. We can find some of the scholars, our friend, criticize somebody too eager to develop a cooperation with China, maybe which will be damage existing the framework of Eurasia Economic Union. Fourth, of course, the key issue, what kind of China's economic development tendency? Too much debates. I couldn't describe or hold the pictures. We can discuss. Another, not only theoretical problem, but also really we found so much different ideas, different behaviors in practice. This challenge means that how to take both in account to ensure the smooth construction of nation states on one hand, and another thing is advanced regional cooperation on others. What means Ukraine crisis? I think such kind of problem also happened to this process. For many emerging countries, particularly located in Eurasia region, there are emerging nation states, also with very deep impact heritage and anything else. When nation state construction couldn't finish, suddenly face so-called integration, such kind of task. So two process, always we can find a conflict between both. And also, some problem happened to SCO itself. The first thing is implementing mutual economic cooperation projects. If we check at least how much so-called multilateral economic cooperation within a framework SCO is finished, I'm not so happy to look at such kind of outcome. Secondly, mutual coordination between economic cooperation and the security affairs. What kind of priority will be emerging, will be formed? I think still the problem. Of course, we can find some outcome finally, but still in processing. Thirdly, further expansion of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. I think this year, next year, we will find some of the new member be appear in the framework of SCO, just like India, Pakistan, and other the country that is not small country. That means the combination of the members of SCO will be more diversified. The pictures, I think, are very complicated than early. So how we do negotiation among the different scales, different different orientation, different social development level, different ideological constructions, countries. That is very tough, the challenge. Nevertheless, on general, I'm cautiously optimistic to look at China-Russia cooperation in Central Asia. The first of all, coordination between Eurasian Union and the One Belt, One Road initiative is a decision made by both President Xi Jinping and President Vladimir Putin. It is a crucial political significance to future cooperation. I didn't want to exaggerate such kind of announcement so important, but anyway, which provide the political guarantee. You know, China and Russia just in process transition, internal transition. That is very tough the question. So how we can make the linkage between internal political economic transition and external cooperation? That is really not easy thing, but need the highest levels politician decide something. Secondly, bilateral cooperation between China, Central Asia countries, multilateral cooperation among China, Russia, and Central Asia. Really, I didn't want to repeat, make new progress. Just our colleague have already show some of the pictures, particularly in some of the fields, besides energy cooperation, in infrastructure, in transportation, really, we can find a big progress. Thirdly, I think EU-China cooperation can provide references for the cooperation between China and the Eurasian Union. What does it mean? For example, currently, particularly last year, we can find China and the EU, the economic cooperation, I think, got so quick progress. That is on Union level, European Union level. But also, we can find the so active interaction between the single country, European single country with China. I think AIIB, that is one case, indicated such kind of the moving. So we can do such kind of things, cooperation with the European peoples. One is on the level of the general European Union level. Another thing is also we can find a way to cooperate with the single countries. So, which can provide some the experiment for further China cooperation between China and the Eurasian Union. Fourth, Sino-Russia cooperation in Central Asia does not mean ruling out the cooperation with the United States. That is very, very important thing. What I mean? Always I repeat that 15 years ago, we can find among the US, Russia, China, under the circumstance of 9/11, such kind of situation, we got to the cooperation there. Why we couldn't repeat such kind of very positive experiment for us? Particularly after the Iran nuclear issues finished. I think for China, for Russia, for US, why we couldn't get the more such kind of the transparency for that kind of very complicated processing. And also, just now, we cope with so terrible enemies, ISIS. Why we couldn't go ahead? Why we couldn't go ahead? Even many times I talk with our Russia's friend and the US friend, by my understanding, the Russia's friend, I think on the very high level, the elite, they also consider how US, Russia, and China working together to promote our cooperation in Central Asia. There are some platforms have already worked. Just for example, Afghanistan's discussions among the China, US, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. Then, of course, Russia friend and Central Asia friend argued that why we couldn't involve in the process. Okay, the next step, absolutely, we can enlarge our discussion. So, even my very close friend from Switzerland told me that maybe such kind of cooperation among Russia, China, and the US, we don't need from very sensitive issues. We can do some experiment in some not so sensitive area. Even some European scholars told me that don't need a huge, big the project, big the investment, only small projects for education, for establishing some of the school, do something help the people's high the people's life standard. Many things we can do. Why we couldn't go ahead? Minimum as a model for further substantial economic political cooperation. Thank you.
Well, speaking as a friend of Kazakhstan, I couldn't help notice that in the briefing there were several usages of the phrase Eurasian Union without the appropriate economic in between, but I'm sure that was just a Freudian slip. Vitaly Kozarev is Associate Professor of Political Science and International Studies at Endicott College in Beverly, Massachusetts. And he is an expert on Chinese-Russian relations and foreign policy.
Thank you so much. It's my privilege to participate in this remarkable event at the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University, famous for its solid traditions and remarkable achievements. And thanks a lot to the director of the program, and Dr. Stent, and also the Dr. Michael David Fox for inviting and for organizing this event. I will briefly, probably after the so authoritative presentations on the issue, on the our panelist, politics of the Eurasian Union. So I would probably briefly say a few words about the predominant Western perceptions of the politics of the Eurasian Union, how to understand, what do we mean by politics of the Eurasian Union, and briefly assess some major results of these initiatives, focusing on the hardships and lay out some ways to overcome, address those difficulties and obstacles. Our interest in the United States, in America, towards such issues as Eurasian integration has long been driven by the traditional geopolitical calculations, highlighting the importance of the Eurasian heartland. In particular, we are all aware of the of America's growing anxiety in regard with the rise of another imperial hegemon in Eurasia, specifically the reincarnation of the conglomerate of a centralized authoritarian, comprising a centralized authoritarian megastate run by the Kremlin regime, which is seen in the West as a strategy of the Soviet Union revival. That's what Dr. Cooley has been elaborating on. Western concerns of the USSR revival are justifiable, since the West the Western democracies see all political hurdles on the way to the formation of truly pluralistic, legitimate and just societies, integral components of the global economic and political order based on certain liberal democratic principles cherished by the West. But such a predetermined linear look at the processes in the post-Soviet space as a battleground for the formation of a new Russian empire may be misleading. It doesn't leave much room for cooperation and joint effort by both East and West to address real security and development threats, which would create conditions for the return of a great game in the region. From the perspective of its internal dynamics, the phenomenon of the Eurasian Union is also often portrayed in the West as an example of a somewhat simplistic approach. Eurasian integration is predominantly perceived in the West as either the product of the EU leaders' personal ambitions or a protective mechanism for the insufficient and corrupt oligarchic economies against the powerful forces of economic globalization and global trade liberalization. Scholars examine the Eurasian Union as an ambitious elitist project, which is more politically rather than economically driven, safeguarding the regional elite's interests from the Western powerful players and China. The prevailing view of the Eurasian Union is that it did make sense while Russia benefited from its oil and gas revenues that enabled Russia to buy the regional elites mostly dependent on their ties with Russia. Since the Ukrainian crisis, however, the two factors affecting the evolution of the Eurasian Union were at place. The decline of the Russian economy suffering from the Western sanctions and plummeting oil prices. And second is the problem of political choice that the junior partners of Russia, with all due respect, now have to make a choice to coordinate their relations, either to coordinate their relations with the Eurasian Union framework, or within the Eurasian Union framework on the one hand, or to move toward more robust interactions with the global economic system on the other. So in the press and in the literature, there are tons of publications about the crisis of the Eurasian Union, of this idea, of this concept, and about the fact that probably the dream wouldn't come true, and the project itself is not very successful, and might even lead to some tensions between the participants of the Eurasian Union, the member states. And even just as based on like the clashes of their respective national interests or some ethnic or identity related conflicts. And there are many examples. I've been reading some publications, including in the Russian ones. China is very careful about this, that they don't publish too much. But despite the fact that there are so many analytical and examining and very, very good reviews of the situation. We see some publications about tensions between, for example, the Kazakhstan leadership and the Russian Kremlin in terms of how to solve economic inconsistencies, the tariffs, and the loss, and especially the devaluation of the ruble. And so these are the lots of economic and finance-related issues. And also there are some publications that the Kazakh leadership and the leaderships of other member states developing their plan B to overcome the crisis. So they want to escape, want to create their own, opportunities, set of opportunities to not necessarily be dependent on the Eurasian Union framework. Lukashenko is at the center of the publications recently as a very reluctant negotiator, as a very nationalistic and self-centered. and even looking again back to the European Union, so kind of like trying to flatter the Europeans and the United States so that he would be recognized as a real indispensable leader of this European country. So what do we see as a result? So we have, I don't want to just elaborate too much on the publication, but what do we see as a result? If we take a look at the three key dimensions of the Eurasian Union, the first one is economic. I don't want to eat other people's lunch speaking too much about economic, because there will be two more panels, like economic and geopolitics. But in the economic, the idea that Eurasian Union might become a bridge between the European Union, like integration process, and the Asia-Pacific integration process now is dying, just due to the rifts between Russia and the European Union, Russia with the West, and the over-dependency of Russia on China in Asia-Pacific affairs. Geopolitically, as an imperial project and the formation of the Eurasian center of power, in a polycentric world, it's also under question, given the very often the Western orientation and like external orientation of other partners. I've just mentioned Lukashenko's policies and Nazarbayev, and just they all have the multivectoral foreign policies, which might not be. Might not be a good foundation for the real Russia-centered, Russia-dominated power center in the geopolitical, from geopolitical perspective. We'll have another panel on geopolitics, so I don't want to speak too much about this. On the political and civilizational, which is the third dimension, so the economic, geopolitical, and civilizational and political dimension, probably we'll like to say a little bit more on this. It was, the whole project was designed especially 2014, as an opposition to the liberal world, an opposition based on an idea that that the Eurasian civilization state might be created. So it was like a civilization state might be created. As the core of a Eurasian power center. It has been designed as a political project to create an alternative to the Western international order and the set of values. And many experts were saying, just like who were founding fathers of this idea, they were speaking about the civilization dimensions, the civilization dimension of global competition. It's kind of another like way to say about to speak about clash of civilizations, probably. Interestingly, is that the future of this project has long been associated with the revival of the Turan civilization, which is represented predominantly by the Turkic countries. And everybody knows about the split between Turkey and Russia, so we probably could evaluate the future, the prospect of the Turan civilization as the lying at the core of the Eurasian political construct and cultural construct. And funny is that Eurasian integration has been promoted as integration in the reverse compared with the European Union integration. What do I mean by this? The Eurasian integration didn't seek to change the countries, because the European integration process was like to upgrade, to change the countries, to change them institutionally, right? And kind of create a standard universal set of values and political standards and frameworks. On the contrary, the Eurasian Union project as a political construct didn't seek to change the countries. It was supposed to help them adopt the integration mechanism to specific characteristics of these countries. So kind of interestingly, it's like a long parochial orientation of Eurasian Union rather than consolidating or like making some sort of like one-size-fits-all type integration. Right. I don't want to say that the United European Union is like one size fits all, but it's like a little bit more standardized, as you know, like Brussels, the bureaucracy, all those like dozens of thousands of standards and regulations that they're living with. So the advocates of a civilization state believed and believe that there is no demands of democratization in the system, for the system. For example, Konstantin Sokolov, a conservative vice president of Russia's Academy of Geopolitical Problems, very widely and broadly published and cited every day in Russian mass media, insists that, quote, people's political power through the communal mechanisms and collectivism would secure success of Eurasian Union. Right? So the sense of community generates creativity and as opposed to Western emphasis on individualistic enrichment. So this very value-related component of Eurasian integration is extremely important and interesting. The Eurasian Union is portrayed as Russia and its partners' response to the shift that occurred in the West from the Christian interpretation of morality and life to a materialistic perception, hedonistic, I would say, perceptions of welfare as the highest value, the pursuit of happiness, which is underpinned by industrial development, market economy, and individual freedoms. I would like to cite Sasha Lukin, who was there, who was in Washington yesterday, and he's probably presenting at Harvard now, who wrote a special article about this value content of Eurasian integration. And he's very, very interesting thoughts. He says that driving force of Eurasian integration is the opposition of the peoples in the region to the secular liberal ideology, mm-hmm. economic and social egoism model, that he says, generated by the West. Nations seeking integration in Asia do not accept to consider individual human rights as an ultimate goal of human development, which trumps over social welfare, stability, harmony. Absolutization of political freedoms and liberation from moral restraints of individual development, that's what he emphasizes. Traditional religions in the Eurasian space all oppose moral relativism, as Alexander Lukin claims, of Western societies and finds a value-based source for successful Eurasian integration. Economy is important in this process, but plays a secondary role. The current Western policy of stimulating internal conflicts in these countries helps the center to consolidate even. So the key question is, would these centers bring value systems and the development models more attractive and efficient than the Western ones? Putin quotes Berdyaev, the meaning of conservatism is not that it slows down our move forward, it prevents us from stepping back the darkness of chaos and primitivism. Ideal attractive alternative model should combine high degree of freedoms and the system of absolute values. That's the idea, the concept which Alexander Lukin has formulated. So like I criticized him for this, but it's like it's still in the process. So it's a very interesting value-related component of this of the project. So what actually? How would we evaluate the result, the outcome of this? So what happened to the evolution of the EU in terms of political development, outcome of this collective effort? So I've just elaborated a little bit on the economic and on geopolitical, so about political and cultural and civilization related. So from the perspective of governance, unfortunately, from the perspective of governance, it was supposed to be the whole system, a political system was supposed to be a replica, become a replica of the EU institutions, European Union institutions of governance, with the supranational institutions, and but it were not, and they were turned out not to be so efficient. As Dr. Cooley said, dysfunctional supranationalism, that's what we are talking about, given the, especially the partner states' reluctance to cede their sovereignty to supranational institutions in reality. The project is developing like an institutionalized bargaining mechanism, which is a little bit better than the CIS mechanism, but still less formalized than the EU one. the Turan civilization, as we all know, understand that it probably is, would be like a dying concept in this case, in the current geopolitical situation, cannot be revived, neither be revived nor replaced by anything else. So kind of civilizational. So what is the core, the roots of identity of Eurasian, future Eurasian identity, which has not been formed, unclear the way toward this Eurasian identity. So what the ways might be toward the formation of Eurasian identity. And the final point is, so what is left? So what is the solution? It's like my conclusion. It's like solution is to focus, to shift the focus and priority in the Eurasian Union construction toward the restoration of an effective state, an effective government. So effective state, so the root is in good governance, so our old good governance, which the World Bank has been talking about. And no wonder, both in all these countries, like all member states, and in China, the good governance concept is like sometimes it's replacing the role and the functionality of democracy is like even better. And when I remember, I spoke with one of the Kazakh grad students here at Georgetown 2 years ago, and I said, so what would you like, how do you look, see democracy? And he says, you know what, in some countries, in some cases, we don't necessarily need democracy, we need good governance, which is like more important for us, for our development, for prosperity, and the pursuit of happiness. And in this respect, just like kind of like elaborating on Professor Feng's thesis, I think that there will be a good opportunity to create some correlations with the One Belt, One Road initiative. And in what sense? I just predict, predicting, I know that I'm done. Predicting what sense, how to secure this cooperation of between China and the members of the EU in terms of like, in terms of this make a real conjunction or real combination. I think that China needs to modify its strategy in Yuan Belt Round Road strategy and introduce the something like buzzword, but it's conditionality. So this is something that we just been all criticized the International Monetary Fund and Washington Consensus. The conditionality. China needs to be not to be humble and just go and despite the fact that Bobo Law insists that nobody in the Eurasian space would really would be willing to listen to be told what to do, right? But at the same time, I think that China has enough power and a possibility, capability to create incentives to persuade regional elites to conduct institutional reforms, to introduce good governance and fight corruption. That's why China has been talking like constantly about fighting corruption and creating the rule of law, establishing the rule of law. And it looks like China is moving in this direction. Thank you so much.
We have more?
This is thank you.
Like the European Union, it's not discipline.
No, thank you.
Okay, so we have 15 minutes. Let's gather three questions at a time to go through, and let's see if we can do two cycles of Andy?
Thanks. Andy Cutchins, Georgetown University. Thank you very much for the presentations. Very simple question. The agreement between Xi Jinping and Vladimir Putin in May of last year for cooperation between the EEU and the Silk Road Economic Belt. What juridical authority did Vladimir Putin have to sign that paper? And what would be the incentives for Belarus, Kazakhstan, Armenia, were they a member at that point? At any rate, what would be the incentives for the other members of the EEU to designate Vladimir Putin the authority to do that?
Mm-hmm. Harley?
Thank you. Alex, one other IR theory question, I guess. Julia Gray has written some really interesting stuff about the 500 or so regional economic organizations that exist in the world, and half to two-thirds of them are what she calls zombies. They still exist. The formal stuff is still there. They still have bureaucratic offices somewhere that continue to turn out reports, but they don't really do anything. What I'm hearing from the three of you is that the Eurasian Economic Union looks much more like a zombie and the SCO looks much more like a real organization.
And yes.
Hi, Jenna Marson. I'm a graduate student and I'm doing a thesis very similar to Dr. Cooley's presentation. And so I was wondering about your perspective on how Russia feels about their own credibility in the EU. My feeling is that they feel that they know they have serious credibility issues and that that's part of the reason they modeled their whole organization on the EU and part of the reason they have this organization at all and part of the reason they're denying the bribes and things of that nature. Thank you.
Great. I'll turn to our panel to address these and start with you, Alex, and go down.
Yeah, sure. I think Andy's point is a really good one, and that, should have been another slide, the first one, the very move of this agreement talking on behalf of the EEU in this sort of bilateral relationship. I mean, to me, this is just the fundamental tension here. It's the fundamental tension, and the way that that I see this getting played out, directives come from Beijing and Moscow, and then how do you make it work, right? So then you set into motion a kind of a set of technocratic processes. It becomes about projects. It becomes about this particular rail corridor and that particular thing. And I think and the overarching questions of sort of authority and purpose tend to sort of blend away because it can't really happen any other way if you're going to go sort of top down. But I think your point's a really good one. Harley, I would disagree, I think, on labeling the EU a zombie organization. I'll tell you why, because the bureaucracy itself is massive, right? It is very substantial. You're talking about 2,000 people in a permanent commission. You're talking about, a couple of dozen departments. You're talking about commissioners. You're talking about a lot of monitoring and review. I see the dysfunction coming from just the inability to keep up to its own commitments and the lack of capacity amongst the member states to implement these directives, right? Which gets me to sort of the next point, and just picking up on Vitaly's very important point. One of the reasons we have conditionality, isn't just to sort of, deride it sort of academically, right? The purpose of conditionality is to ensure that institutions behave in a way that they can actually implement supranational directives, right? That's the whole point of the EU's accession process. Right, that your institutions are capable of implementing directives from above. And so, to me, unless you deal with institutional reform, right, the idea that these directives can come out of this 2,000-person bureaucracy and that they'll be implemented in Yerevan or Bishkek as they're intended, well, it's just there on paper. Now, I wouldn't call that zombie. I would call that deep dysfunction, I guess, right? That's my, zombie implies that it's just there in name only. It's not there in name only. And actually, again, the trajectory 2010, 2012, you had some substantial integration and also some decisions against Russia that went there. And then I think, just your point on credibility, absolutely it's a Russian concern, but I think, the timing is unfortunate in that credibility gets tested in times of crisis, right? Sort of a fundamental lesson of political economy, and Russia hit 2014, which magnified its credibility with all these different crises, which I think exposed their credibility issues.
Dr. Feng?
Andy's question is, I think, it's very interesting. Some years ago, we know President Vladimir Putin, when he answered the question about what kind of relationship between Eurasian Union and the SCO, he mentioned that it's two different things. It's not such kind of linkage between both things. He emphasized on this term. But why now he tend to prefer more cooperation with China by the initiative of One Belt, One Road? I think, of course, there are some objective circumstances, just like crisis happen and economic situation decline. And also, his strategy turned to Asia, economic strategy turned to Asia. But also I'd like to mention his personal contact with Xi Jinping himself. That is also one element. And finally, I think Central Asia's countries elite also positively encourages this process. By the way, maybe we can accord some lessons from Ukraine crisis. Why EU integration that is very positive integrated, and Eurasian Union, and of course also positive process, obviously. What reason for final the crisis happened? I think the first thing is not only the ideological and geopolitical strategy different, and also just like my colleague emphasized, the bureaucratic system really seriously impacted on whole the process. I remember one scholar wrote articles show that even between both sides, there is no political awareness to conduct on such kind of very current conflict, coming conflict. Finally, I think I agree with Professor Angela Stein. She mentioned, of course, on other articles, maybe knowledge preparing also problem. I mean, particularly, I think in China also, when we launch the program One Belt One Road, really, I don't think we have already got very nice knowledge to prepare. Any bureaucrat, any officials, even the scholars, you know everything in Central Asia, you know everything in Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, some of the corners, very interesting changing. Yeah. It's very tough, the question. So really, there's a long, long way for us if we'd like to sincerely promote institutional cooperation. Thank you.
Dr. Kosovo?
Yeah, just there were two questions. One about from Andy about the how just this agreement was signed. I think that for for China before visiting to Moscow, there had been an arrangement with the partners of the Eurasian Union that, and then she actually traveled further to Kazakhstan and Belarus after Moscow, and there was a real buzz in the Moscow that why wouldn't Putin could have invited the leaders and just signed this important agreement with the Chinese leader, and that could have been a very logical and very nice, I would say, diplomatically and politically step. And I think it was a mistake. But overall, I thought probably it was mostly China was like rushing to sign this agreement with experts told me that it was mostly a Chinese initiative to sign this and to reassure Russia. It was a very hard time for Russia that China would not experiment and would not take advantage given the difficulties for the Russian economy and the split with the West in the soft Russian soft underbelly, in the just like in the Eurasian space, in the post-Soviet space. So that was probably the primary reason. That's why she decided to sign just directly with Russia. To what extent that was coordinated between Russia and Nazarbayev and the other leaders, it's a question. Might have been. So I don't see that nobody really just said anything with this regard in the other member states. And one small point about Russia's credibility. The system works in the way that Russia's credibility, Russia is credible as long as there is understanding, personal understanding between Putin and Nazarbayev and Putin and Lukashenko. So this is that's how the system works. It's like less institutionalized. We all know about how Vladimir Putin makes decisions. Sometimes I've heard from Russian diplomats, that you could have paid a lot of efforts to coordinate something with one of these Central Asian countries and prepare documents, and then President Putin would go and talk in tete-a-tete
eye to eye to the leader and then come out with a different solution, right? So all could be recycled. So this is the way politics is being done. So probably that is a weak point, that Russia's credibility is like mostly the credibility of a strongman, right? So we need to probably pay more efforts to advance and to institutionalize so that Russia might be having credibility without judo and without any personal interests. Thank you so much.
Three more questions. Yes.
Thank you very much. Alexander Liebmann, German Institute for International and Security Affairs. I have a brief question to Alexander Cooley regarding the importance of complete versus incomplete contracts in the context of Eurasian regionalism. Incomplete contracts may be a problem if either you have an external force which would enforce a complete contract, which anyway isn't existing there, or if the members are committed to manipulating only within the existing contractual structure, which is also not the case there, because the countries just partly disregard whatever they sign. Then my question is, if you had a complete contract, and then at some point of time Russia would say, well, we have to retaliate to Western sanctions, let's do something, would it change the situation fundamentally? And I can't resist saying a word about Andy's question. I can give you an answer which the Russian diplomats gave me. And they said that exactly on that day, or I think the day after, there was an informal CIS summit in Moscow, which explicitly endorsed the declaration Xi Jinping and Putin signed.
Another question? Yes, in the back.
Hi, David, intern with the Hudson Institute. So far, you guys have talked a lot about international organizations, or rather regional ones, and how they can affect the interactions between countries. I know the discussion has been focused mostly on China and Russia and their actions, but you also brought up Iran, the SEO. I was curious, how do you see China and Russia interacting with Iran, especially through the SEO, considering the nuclear deal and opportunities for interactions in energy and other elements like counterterrorism? Do you think it'll be beneficial for China and Russia, or do you think that they're going to still limit Iran on potential issues in the future? Thank you.
One more question?
Okay,
this is it. Ask the panelists to respond and also give any final.
I think what I find analytically interesting about this, institutional design mechanism is that, this is an extreme case of, severe acute power asymmetry and incompleteness, right? So how do you manage that, right? How do you reassure the others? It's almost, especially when it's the lead power that is contributing to the incompleteness, right? So it's a tough one. That's why I throw in the example of NAFTA, right? It's the only other example I know of, how was Mexico and Canada, how were they reassured? It had to be on putting very strict boundaries and limits on what exactly NAFTA was doing, right? And promising absolutely no more, and this is the means of redress. It just seems to me everything in the EU is the polar opposite to that. I'd like to tell you your point about, the credibility of leadership then sort of stepping in and functioning as a proxy. Maybe that's the break. I don't know. But I think we're in uncharted institutional territory, but I still think it's institutional. They're institutional dynamics. So I don't want to dismiss them. It's just analytically, how do we get a hold on them? And then how do you translate that into a policy recommendation about engagement? That, I think, is the challenge. Without sort of piling on to the geopolitical implications of what you're doing. I think that's the tough part. I'll just say one thing on the SCO. I think clearly now the way is open for Iranian membership in the SCO. It's not going to signify the same kind of counter-hegemonic aspirations that it would have in 2007. As you mentioned, I think very effectively, the SCO has always had real problems on the multilateral economic front. And every sort of major economic initiative that's been introduced by Beijing, Moscow behind the scenes has stopped, whether it's an anti-crisis fund, a regional development bank, a free trade organization. So I don't see how Iran's addition into that fabric or framework is going to magically give it some sort of economic capacity that it didn't have before. That's just my opinion.
Dr. Feng?
I'd like to answer the question about Iran issues, how China, Russia, the cooperation.
during the process. I think both sides, of course, US and European side also insist very clear principles, non-proliferation of nuclear weapon. That is very important thing. So I think as parliament from the process dealing with Iran, I think could be a spirit to other issues, just like the peninsula issue. Other things, I think each party not only respect each other, but also share their responsibility. I think that is very important things for solving such kind of very terrible situation. By the way, I think after the end of the dealing with Iran and the Ukraine issue, I think still in this region face very complicated strategic situation. So just by this meeting, I think the cooperation among the Russia, US, Europe, and China still needed.
I would like to follow up Professor Feng's complexity and the role of strategic and security related issues around Iran. And I think that the SCO will be a great optimal actual mechanism and framework for coordinating some economic and security issues with Iran. So like that's good that Iran and India and Pakistan. So there will be nice format secure this type of cooperation and to avoid misunderstanding and mistrust. Because Sanal Ras mentioned yesterday at another conference that there are many publications saying that China and Russia will compete in Iran just over the access to the Iranian like lucrative projects. And it looks like this SCO will be a good good venue to coordinate this and to do many things together. So and that will be supported by Iran as well.
Great. Just one comment on Kazakhstan. Being largest landlocked country in the world, it is very dependent on the EU working smoothly so mm-hmm. the trade can go across borders. Mm-hmm. President Nazarbayev's exceptional authority has been a significant break on abuse of relationships within the EU and has helped work hard to help Kazakhstan work hard in the Commission to make this a rules-based organization. Someday President Nazarbayev will no longer be in power, and so the ability of Kazakhstan and Belarus, especially then, to be able to modulate this, it's going to be a challenge unless the rules, the institutions are built ahead of time. Thank you very much. Let's thank our panelists.